No, my name's...
Trevor's here. Trevor's not here.
No, Trevor.
No, Trevor. All right, like Mr. Cole said, my name is Eric Blanchard. I live right in town. I'm not going to tell you where. I don't want anybody just dropping by. I've been a game warden for 14 years. I've been doing crash reconstructions for like five now, maybe five or six. I also part of the forensic mapping team. You see that piece of equipment over there? Kind of like looks like survey equipment. We use that to measure accurately both crashes and hunting-related incidents or anything that we need, like a two-scale drawing, an accurate scale drawing. Anybody seen surveys on the side of the road? The same thing, same stuff. I'll show you some drawings later that we do based on some of the crashes that I've reconstructed. There's two crashes that we're going to go over. They're both snowmobile related. And one of them has to do with the physics behind it. It's kind of like the big physics behind it is sliding and coefficient of friction. You guys know what that is? You sure? All right, we're going to find out. I want good answers. All right, so if I have something like this, a hockey puck that's 1 kilogram on ice, what are the forces working on that? What are the forces on that hockey puck? It's just sitting there first.
Gravity?
Gravity, right. So what's gravity do to it?
Keeps the, it's sort of the force, pretty much kind of does this, pretty much, kind of keeps the puck here.
Makes it still, right? Keeps
right,
it still.
Right. Or else, if there was no gravity on it, it would probably be like,
yep, so we got gravity. So the force, what's force? You guys, I know you know this. Yeah. Mr. Cole's going to snap if you don't give me an answer. I can see him over there, just seething. He's gonna
smile.
He's smiling.
He's smiling.
Oh my gosh, he's smiling.
Yeah. All right, so we have force. What's force? What do you need for force? You need something to
have push it, like a push.
Need a mass, right?
Like a push or a
mass?
Pull.
Mass?
A push or a pull?
Push or a pull.
Or,
yep.
Or in this case of the hockey puck, probably like a hockey stick.
Yep, you need something for the gravity to work, all right? So we have a hockey puck. Have you guys heard this? Force is equal to mass times acceleration?
You should all at this point say, yes.
You guys are brutal. You're all freshmen? I teach at SMCC. I teach algebra today. If my class was just quiet, they would all flunk.
You good with that?
Yes. All right. Liven up a little bit. You gotta liven down a little bit. You're perfect. All right, so mass times acceleration. What's the acceleration of gravity in metric units? I'm gonna start giving extra credit. Can I give extra credit?
Sure.
What can we make? We need a carrot at the end of this. What type of credit?
We get a test Friday.
Just like, all right. You start getting an extra point in your test? You like that?
That works for me.
All right. Here we go. We're going to start giving out extra points on tests because I've got to get somebody to talk. Last class when we talk. You guys want to pass this test? Be a little nervous about it? You don't get it, man. All right. So what is acceleration in metric units? What's the value? Somebody come close.
Come on.
You heard of this? 9.81. meters per second squared.
Acceleration?
Acceleration of gravity, right?
Right.
Okay, that's
right.
Important.
Acceleration could be the change of like, it could be negative, like slowing down or speeding up or in any direction or something.
Yep, acceleration is...
pretty much a change.
Yep, acceleration multiplied by a mass will give you a force, right? Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So it's mass times gravity will give you the force of the hockey puck down, but there's also a force working up. It's called the normal force of the ice on the mass, right?
Right, pretty
and
much.
If it's just there, then that's going to be equal to each other, right? Because it's stationary.
Okay, it's balanced.
Right. When forces are equal to each other, they're balance, right? All right, now, my hockey puck is moving to the right. If it's on ice, you guys remember what coefficient of friction is?
No.
Coefficient of friction, right? If it's on ice, is the coefficient of friction going to be high or low?
Low.
Low, right? That's almost the point, but not quite. That was a little too easy. All right, we'll work on the point. That was good. All right, so if I slid a hockey puck across ice, coefficient of friction is going to be low, right? How about if I take that same hockey puck and slide it across the parking lot? Will it go as far as it did on ice?
No.
So what's the coefficient of friction going to be? Higher or
high.
It's going to be higher, right?
Yeah, plus that, I think I might break the hockey puck.
Yep. For crash analysis, coefficient of friction. Now, the hockey puck's going this way, if it's on ice, it's going to go a long way. There's going to be some friction working against it. And the friction force is actually the normal force times the coefficient of friction. And I think it's remembered. It's written as like a U or something. Coefficient of friction, right? And that's going to be resisting it. Friction force. Does that make sense? You good with that? Okay, the friction force is real important to crash reconstruction. All right? For some analysis. For a lot of analysis, it's very important. The reason that it's important is because of this formula. I'm going to give you a formula that we use to figure out speed of cars or anything sliding. Okay. Police officers use it for measuring skid marks. If a car is sliding along and it locks its brakes up before it hits something, police officers measure, or I do too sometimes, measure the distance of the skid to tell how fast the car was going, right? The formula that they use is this one. S is equal to the square root of 30 times D times F. Okay? Speed, S is what? Speed, right? How's speed usually measured? On your speedometer.
Miles per hour?
Miles per hour, good. Miles per hour, right? Does that make sense? Okay, here's the problem. Is that D in this formula is equal to distance in feet. Can I have distance in feet and speed in miles per hour in the same formula usually? What do I have to do? What do I have to do? If I measure something in feet and I want it in miles, what do I have to do? That's good. That's awesome. Good job. I have to convert feet into miles per hour, right? There's 5,280 feet in a mile. Does that make sense? So I have to do a conversion. Conversions are something that you guys should be either starting or you will be doing a lot in physics. You do it a lot in introductory physics.
You think about how we've done conversions between kilometers and meters. We're trying to find something in kilometers per hour or meters per second. This is just the other side of that, not using the metric system, where you're dealing with feet and miles.
Yep. To me, the metric system is like way easier.
Like way easy,
but everybody's great. Back when I was a kid, when I was your age and younger, they were talking about going to the metric system. This is back in maybe the early 80s, late 70s, maybe. And like my elementary school, they were talking about going to the metric system. We haven't done that yet. I don't know why. I think we're the like last country holding out hope that we're going to go back to like feet and pounds and the whole thing. They're trying to figure out like mass in the imperial system or our system is ridiculous. You got like slugs and you do that, you get into slugs at all. You don't even touch it anymore. You don't even get near it.
Oh, we can help.
That's great. I don't like slugs. I'm talking about mass, not like little squirmy things. Alright, so I need this. What else is in this? What's F do you think? What would we talk about? Come on.
Would be friction.
Friction, the coefficient though, right? That's what I need. I need the coefficient. Okay? So once I get all that, I can figure out my speed. My speed in this formula is what I want. On this analysis that we're going to do, what time is this one over?
We are over at
9:30.
9:30, okay. I'm just trying to pace.
Good.
Okay. So on this crash reconstruction we're going to do, I measured the skids of a snowmobile before it hit the shoreline and then went up underneath the boat lift. Okay, what happened was this operator, he might have had too much to drink. He's coming across the lake. He sees he's got a passenger on the back, female passenger. He's getting close to shore and locks up the brakes. What happens on a snowmobile when the brakes lock up? Anybody know? Who rides a snowmobile? Anybody know?
Oh.
You look like you've ridden the heck out of a snowmobile.
Yeah.
Just get that look. What happens when a snowmobile locks up?
I remember learning this. It kind of goes out of control in a way. It's
yep.
sort of kind of, it kind of, you know, it's hard to steer.
Yep, it is
and
hard to steer.
Exactly, it kind of makes you go like there's like a turn, and then when the lakes rock up.
Yep, it does all that. But when you put the brakes on the snowmobile, you know that track on the back? That locks up completely, okay? And the snowmobile will start to slide.
Exactly.
So when we get a slide across something, what can I now find out when something's sliding, like the hockey puck? Yeah, we're going to get a skid mark, but we're going to be able to find the F, right? That's what we need. We need all of this. We need the distance that it skids, and we need a coefficient of friction in order to get S, right? In this formula. What this is, it's a very watered-down, easy version of physics and math. They'd make it like that so police officers and game wardens can understand math. And it doesn't get too intense. We don't have to do conversions. We just use that formula. Once we measure distance and coefficient of friction, then we'll be able to get speed miles per hour. So in this crash, he slid about 177 feet, hit the shoreline. Oh, actually, we're going to do it right now. Want to get into it right now? I'll show you a picture. Here's the snowmobile. Okay. When I get to the scene, this is all I had. Well, it's not all I had, it's part of what I had. What looks strange about this snowmobile? If I'm just looking at it, what's kind of out of the ordinary that would give me an indication as to what happened during the crash? Give me a one pointer. Go ahead. Yep, what do you think that might be? Yeah, could have. Yeah, definitely could have. Go ahead. He flipped it. He rolled it. That's right. There was actually some pieces of the windshield at the scene as well. So when we know that, there was a rollover part of the crash. And other things gave us an indication there was a rollover as well. The way he hit the shore, the angle that the snowmobile hit the shoreline. Go ahead.
I'm wondering if that's a major factor about the... Looks like a lot of the parts of the... Looks like there might be some snow stuck in the engines, and the wheels seem a little... And the tire tracks seem a little...
Yeah, they're definitely ice. They definitely have ice in them, but that's not too unusual for a
snowmobile.
Yeah,
but the tire... Well, the tire tracks look a little broken-y.
Yeah, they're a little broken-y. All right, here's the next one. Let's see. All right, so there's a picture of the snowmobile, and here's kind of what happened. The snowmobile was already upright. It was like this when I got to the scene the next day. Yeah, the next day. If you can see it, and you'll be able to see it better in the next picture. You see that and that?
Mm-hmm.
See those marks in the ice?
Oh, are those snow skid marks?
These are the skis, okay? See that right there? Where the track is, that's where the snowmobile was skidding. So as he was coming into the shore, you see how these things kind of veer off to the right? His nose, as he was coming in, was kind of like sliding off that way. But he was still skidding, right? Okay, we need all that. We need to do a good at-scene analysis in order to get a good reconstruction.
Oh, so, I think I get what happened.
You do? Okay, this might even be better. This actually probably... shows it a little bit better. This is actually as you get closer to the shore and as he went sideways. So this is going to be like part of the track and that's part of the track. It was a little bit more obvious at the scene, but he was still skidding Then when he hit the shoreline, he started to roll, right? Because he kind of came in sideways. And
yeah, that's actually what I was thinking. It was skidding, then all of a sudden, then friction caught up with it in the on the snow pile, then just kind of flipped it over. And
yep, he definitely flipped it over. And here's the last part.
What?
Okay, that red stuff is blood. I feed you guys a freshman, you can see blood. So when he hit the boat lift, he went in kind of like head first. The snowmobile stopped up against the boat lift and he kept going. He kept going. No helmet on, probably hurt. But gives you a reason why you shouldn't operate a snowmobile or any other vehicle when you're under the influence of alcohol. So he didn't die, but he got charged with OUI. His passenger, luckily, was fine. Well, that's what happened. That's kind of some of the pictures I took at the scene. Now we will get into the actual crash report. Actually, it's right here. How do we get rid of that?
If you click on the, if you just go to the right, if you keep going and click on the one, now keep going a little bit further. Then yep. Click on that, you'll pull it right up.
Look at that. I don't use Apple computers. I'm not computer literate. I just don't use Apples. Okay. My daughter's in second grade in Wells Elementary, and that's all she uses is Apples. You guys have great school. All right, so here's my crash reconstruction report. This is the first sheet on it. What it does is it gives all of the wardens that were at the scene. Well, the primary investigating officer is right here, which was Chris. Right there. And then I'm up here doing the reconstruction. You guys have to put your name on your paper. You ever get in trouble for not putting your name on your paper? I guarantee some of you guys are just like notorious for not putting your name on your paper. Mr. Cole has to figure out who did it. I get college students who still won't do it. Alright, so here's the vehicle that crashed. It was a 1997 Skidoo. I have to put all this down in case years later there's some sort of civil charges or whatever. I need a very accurate report. So all this stuff is very important. Here's a synopsis as kind of just what happened briefly. Like when you're doing a report, you do like an internet. You guys done a lab report yet? Have you done a lab report yet? You guys, Mr. Cole's back there nodding. You guys have given me like no answer.
I had it.
Have you done a lab report? You done one? Have you turned it in yet? You're still wondering. Have you done a lab report?
No.
Okay. All right, so you guys have all done lab reports, right? With introductions, you kind of like briefly tell what happened. Okay, we do the same thing. It's called a synopsis. This is what briefly happened during the crash. This isn't very detailed, but just what happened. I just described it as a snowmobile traveling across Thomas Pond during the day in Casco. Snowmobile approaches shoreline, operator pried the brakes, snowmobile skidded for a long distance. Snowmobile turned sideways, rolled over, ejecting the operator and passenger from the snowmobile. I talk about the injuries. The operator sustained a broken neck, severe lacerations. The passenger sustained bruising during the crash. Nobody was wearing a helmet. Operator was charged with OUI. That is very briefly what happened. Is that my whole report? Is the introduction your whole report? No. Do you guys do like introductions and procedures then conclusions?
Yes.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, you do all that in a report, right? Because all of that information is important. The introduction tells what you're going to be doing during the experiment. Procedure tells you how you did it. Conclusion tells what you learned about it, right? I do the same thing, more or less, in crash reconstructions. Okay, here's the people involved. They have very strange names. They're all both named for X. Is that funny? A little bit? No. You guys are tough. Traffic and trail conditions. Why is that important? I need to know, anybody who reads this needs to know, what kind of surface it was, if there was any other snowmobiles in the area that may have caused a crash. Right? You think all that's important? This is a Google Earth picture of the area that the snowmobile crashed. Where the thumbtack is. I just put that in to give just a general idea of the overall area. Weather conditions. On any crash, I'll call the National Weather Service. and get the exact forecast of what the conditions were at that time of the crash. Just the detail that you need to put in to make a complete report. Details of investigation. Okay, it gets a little more specific in here. I didn't get up to the crash until the next day. I met with two guys that were at the scene, two wards that were at the scene. They started explaining to me what happened. We looked at the scene generally. So when we get up there, I didn't really know. There hasn't been a ton of testing with snowmobiles and getting a coefficient of friction value, which is super important. I knew how far it skidded, right? How did I know? How did I know? I used that equipment to measure it, right? Could have done it with a tape measure, but that's very accurate. So I want to fill in this formula. If I have one equation, how many unknowns can I have in order to get an answer? One equation, I have three variables here, right? How many variables do I need to get an answer? How many known variables? I gotta have two, right? I know D, which is the distance in feet the snowmobile skidded. I need to know the coefficient of friction, right? How am I gonna do that? Maybe an experiment? Good idea? Yeah. So what happened, how we get that coefficient of friction, is that one of the game wardens at the scene had a snowmobile that was kind of similar. Have you guys ever seen a track in a snowmobile that has metal picks in there?
Studs.
Yeah, picks, studs, yeah. I'll show you a picture. I actually took the picture. So, I had a hard time finding it 10 years ago. Stand by. So, keep going.
Motorcycle.
What's that?
I
thought
it was a Warden motorcycle.
There's some more pictures we'll get into.
How long is that report kept on file?
What the?
This report's kept on file forever.
Really?
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, it's on our database, you know. I submit it on our database, and it's pretty much there. There's really no end to how long we keep it. So here's a picture of one of the sleds, and I can't remember if it was the... Okay. Here's our test sled. Here's our snowmobile that we used. This is the game warden snowmobile, okay? And that has pick tracks. And then the suspect, or the operator sled, had picks that looked like this. They weren't exact, but they were close enough to conduct a pretty good experiment, right? Okay, so what we needed was that coefficient of friction. We did that by running what we call test skids. Test skids, all right. Here's the thing. I'm not going to give this to you quite yet. So, if I have that formula, and I want to solve for F, what do I have to do? I have S is equal to the square root of 30 DF, and I want to solve for F. You guys got to help me. I want to solve for F. What do I have to do first? Somebody wants a point on their test. You guys. I'm going to just start picking on you guys. And I can pick on people, believe me. And the person that's looking at me the least is probably going to get picked on. Actually, you volunteered. You saved everybody. What do I do? I have the distance. What I want to do is solve this formula for F. You guys, I know you're all taking algebra, most of you. So I want F isolated on the left side.
You want to rearrange for F.
I got to rearrange for F.
What do you have to do?
What's the first thing I have to do? Go ahead.
I don't know.
How about if I square both sides?
Oh, okay.
You guys all taking algebra?
No. Geometry.
Geometry, you're all taking. So you've already taken algebra, is what you're saying to me.
Yes.
That's what you're saying to me? You gave me no answer? I'm going to have to talk to somebody. You guys might be all sophomores.
Daniela.
You guys are going to be at sophomores for a while in this phase. Okay, you're all freshmen? You were taking geometry, though? So you've taken algebra. All right. So you square both sides, right? So my first step now is my square root sign goes away. And I square F, I square both sides, right? Now I want to solve for F. What do I have to do? If this is 30 times D times F.
Divide F.
Yeah. Don't I divide each side by 30D? All right, so now this is the formula, 30 times D. That's the formula that I used in order to solve for coefficient of friction, right? How did I do that? How did we do that? I put a young game warden on top of the state sled. Not that I'm not young, but this warden got on the state sled that was picked. The track was picked just like the operator's sled. He had his GPS in his hand. When he hit 30 miles per hour, he locked up the brakes and slid across the ice. We did it the next day, so the ice conditions were very similar. So what do you think we did after that? When he stopped, what do you think we wanted? What do you think we wanted? We knew the speed. He was going 30 when he hit the brakes. Go ahead.
How far he skimmed?
How far he skimmed a point. You get a point. That's good. How far he skidded, right? Because then I'll have, I got the speed, I got D, there's my F. When you do an experiment like that, how many times? You do it just once. Do I do it once and say, there, I'm done?
You repeat it so you get more results to compare?
Yeah, you repeat it so you can get a pool of results. So if you've got one or two crazy answers, then you might have done something wrong in the experiment, right? Does that make sense? Like an outlier? You get a pool and then you look at stuff that's kind of like, doesn't make sense. Maybe you can drop them if you have a lot of different chances, if you have a lot of information. Okay, so that's what we did. We did it four times. After I solved that formula, see where it says now F is equal to S squared over 30D? Now here's the thing, is that the reason I put that in there is so somebody knows what the heck I'm doing, right? Even though I know what I'm doing, you still put it in a report to show a procedure so the reader, if they have no idea about reconstruction, can kind of figure it out. Does that make sense? So you want a good detailed report. Following results of the test kit. Okay, here we go.
Eric, what would happen if you didn't write down your procedure and then you went to court? They fought.
If you want as much detail as you can when you go to court. If you go to court and everything's not in there, number one, you may forget what happened at the scene, so you can't really testify to something you can't remember, right? What a report does is refresh your memory when you go to court, and it also gives the defense attorney what's called discovery, so they have a defense for their client. And unless you put in all of your evidence, sometimes you get the case thrown out. So you put down everything you did as clearly as possible.
Are you the only one making these calculations at the scene, or are there others doing the same?
I'm doing the math part of it. Doing the measurements, I have other game wardens usually helping, holding the tape. Yeah, taking measurements, stuff like that. What happens with the reconstruction? I'll do the reconstruction and then send it up and get it approved to the reconstruction unit. And, they'll review it. You need checks and balances in anything like this. You know, yeah, because you could easily screw something up and somebody else catches it, just like you proofread something. Does that make sense? So if you mess it up and you don't enter it as official report, you want to proofread, do rough drafts, do stuff over. Makes sense? Okay. So here's what we got. Our first skid that we did was 85 feet. The coefficient of friction worked out to 0.35. We did three more skids. And we got 110 feet, 113, and 110. That's pretty accurate, right? Our coefficient of friction values was on our last three skids was 0.31, 0.3, and 0.31. Our first one was 0.35. Which one do you think is kind of an outlier? 0.35, right? So that's why if we just would have taken the first one, it wouldn't have been accurate. So we did it three more times. And what the requirement is that you need two skids in a row within 5% of each other. So we had that. Now, I've got the coefficient of friction for the snow wheel going across the ice, right? I usually, I think, I finally ended up using like a 0.3 or 0.31, I can't remember, what I intend to report. One of the other parts of this crash, do I have everything? Do I have all of the movement of the snowmobile yet? Some of you guys may remember. Actually, before I can do that in a minute. So it's coming across the lake, then it hits the uphill part, right? This is kind of an exaggerated uphill part. It hits a boat lift. Let me show you the diagram. I kind of forgot to show you. How do I pull up another file out of this?
You pull that, you go to the top of it, pull it down a little bit. Yep, and evaporate another file.
I am like dabble illiterate. Is it possibly dabble illiterate? Okay, here we go. All right, here is the diagram that I did using that equipment right there. What I got from his crash was 177.6 feet across the ice. I knew he started to skid because I saw the track marks on the picks went from very clearly defined to where you can see the ice starting to get pushed and everything's kind of straight, right? Make sense? So we slid 177.6 feet, and then he hit the shoreline, and the snowmobile rolled slightly uphill 17.7 feet into the boat lift. So I've got the first part of it. I got the first part of it accounted for, right? I have to account for this last part now. So if this was 177.6, this was 17.7, and then he hit the boat lift, I still have to do this, right? Is my coefficient of friction going to be the same when it's rolling across snow on shore as it was across the ice? Probably not, right? Because you think it's going to be more or less. A rolling snowmobile across snow going slightly uphill is probably going to have a higher coefficient of friction, right? Okay, they've done a bunch of tests on rollers of motorcycles, which structurally is pretty similar to a snowmobile, right? Plastic engine. Basically it. The rollover on asphalt is around a 0.6 for a snowmobile. So what I did was I took it down one to a 0.5, but then it was 0.04 slope, something like that, slightly uphill. So I used a coefficient of friction of 0.54. Now, I have data saying that a motorcycle is around a 0.6 on asphalt, and I know. So do you think a 0.54 for a snowmobile going across snow is pretty close? Yeah, it's pretty close. I'm not going to roll a sled. The other warden might have if I asked him to. He probably would have. But I'm not going to ask him to. So that's what I used for that second part. And let me get out of here. Look at that. You get so good with the apple.
No problem.
Look at it. It's kind of small.
Yeah, we lost a
lot. Where'd it go? Back.
Oh, you see that little thing in the bend there?
Holy apple, literate. All right, so here's what I did. Now everything's going to be taken into account. There was a 4.3% change going uphill. That was measured, right? Because actually, that thing there will take elevation changes too. I know all of my elevation changes after I map. I need the elevation changes, right? That's why that's so important. We used to have to do it by hand. So we'd have to run a flat string and then take an elevation change going down over a certain. You guys know how to do this? Something like that. So if this was level and the ground was kind of going like this, you could figure a slope by going rise over run, right? You can do that. It's pretty easy. Okay. That's how we used to have to do it by hand. That's way better. Trust me, way better. Good English. I like that. Could you delete that? The way better.
No. Not yet.
You're gonna keep that.
I'm waiting for you to say wicked.
Wicked? Wicked's coming. I'll have you wicked before it's over. All right. So here we go. We have a combined speed This is the formula that we use when we have two different F values in two different parts of the crash. To me, there was two different parts of the crash. It was a skidding on the ice. A skidding on the ice, he hit the shore, then he rolled over. All of this is taken into account in this formula. It's our combined speed equation. It's very easy. All this is order of operations, right? You guys know what that is? Somebody give me the order of operations. Go ahead. Very good. Very good. All point maybe for her.
Sure.
Yeah, point for you. Yeah. So what this is just, you guys can do this math, no problem. Multiply inside of parentheses, add underneath the square root, right? Because that's considered grouping symbol. Take the square root, and you've got 43.3 miles per hour. Okay, that's the minimum speed that snowmobile can be going. What can't I take into account? And I'm not sure if I mentioned this, but I will show you. Right here. When he crashed, why does that go so fast? I did it last time. Okay. All right, so what happened is the snowmobile hit this post. See that little dent right there? That's from the snowmobile. So the snowmobile hadn't stopped completely, right? It was still going a certain speed, fast enough to bend that post.
Yes.
Do I know how much energy it takes to bend that post? There's no way I'm going to get that. We're not going to do, we're not going to send the post out. If the case was important enough, we could probably figure it out, right? Find out how much energy it takes to bend that post. We're not going to do that with this. We're going to say that we can't take the extra speed into account. Now, how much speed do you think it takes for a very heavy snowmobile to bend a hollow aluminum post? Probably not much, right? Comparatively. It's probably going less than 10 miles per hour. I can't say that specifically, though, because I don't know. So I can't put that into a crash report. All I can do is say that the energy that it takes to bend that pole is unaccounted for. So the minimum speed that snowmobile was going at the start of the skid was 43 miles per hour. Does that make sense? Kinda. Sort of. Good. So that was that crash. You guys have any questions about that crash? So what happened, actually, just a little better picture, is that when the snowmobile hit, he kept going. Snowmobile stopped, he kept going, right? If he was still on the snowmobile at this point, if he was still sitting on the snowmobile after the rollover, snowmobile stops, how fast is he going to be going the rest of the way? However fast the snowmobile is going when it stopped, right? If you're still on it. Make sense? This kind of leads us into our next part, which is called projectile motion. The other thing that we use quite a bit, have you guys done projectile motion yet? Like a ball getting thrown, how far does it go, what angle? Not yet? Yeah. You will. It's actually kind of cool. Motorcyclist is going down the road. Car pulls out in front of him. He hits it. Motorcycle stops, keeps going, and lands a certain distance, right? How fast is he going when he hit the car? How fast is the motorcycle's going, how fast is the rider going? Say the motorcycle's going 50. How fast is the rider going?
50.
50. If the motorcycle stops, how fast is the rider going to be going when he flies over that car?
50.
About 50, right? If he doesn't hit the handlebars or anything like that, he's going to keep going 50. What are the forces working on him? What's the force working on that motorcycle rider? What's the only force working on that motorcycle rider? When he's flying through the air, what's working on him? What's your enemy at that time when you're 20 feet above asphalt? What's the worst thing?
Gravity.
Gravity! Yeah, gravity's bad. Gravity's good. What makes it hurt? So if gravity's the only force working on any projectile, there are formulas that we can use to figure out the speed at the beginning of the launch, right? Makes sense. So I'm going to show you another crash right here. Okay, here's the thing about this crash. is that it was a fail. It took place in 2011 up in Tim Pond. Tim Pond is up past like Rangeley area. You guys ever went up there? You have any idea where Tim Pond is? It's kind of in the middle of nowhere. And what happened, I'll show you just the analysis that I used. Then I'll show you some pictures. Pictures are always better, right? Can you guys see that at all?
No.
Probably not. How do I expand all this?
Up the top.
I gotta learn how to use that. Okay, that's good. We'll go back to that. We'll go down to here. Yep, perfect. Okay, what happened? Snowmobile's coming up a trail. He's going fast. It's a big wide trail. You see pictures. It's probably as wide as his room. Anybody have a snowmobile up north? They're like highways up there. And on certain flat spots, you can get going. The acceleration of a snowmobile is crazy on a lot of them now. So you can get going real fast, real quick. The problem with that is sometimes you have to stop. And if you're going 80 miles per hour, it takes you a lot longer to stop than if you're going 30. Does that make sense? So speed is fun, but it's also, I guess, sometimes fatal. So in this case, it was. So he's coming up a trail. He's got like 3-4 sleds in front of him that he's riding with. Real powdery snow, and there's a lot of snow dust. He couldn't see. Soon enough, his buddies pulled over, and he hit the back of one of the snowmobiles that was stationary. He got thrown up over the handlebars and landed his feet hit another snowmobile that was parked up here, and actually broke the taillight, but he died right there at the scene. Probably, I don't know for sure, but it was probably like a broken neck. So anyway, the crash analysis consisted of a projectile launch, right? We knew exactly where he landed. The problem with this that we couldn't account for exactly is that the snowmobile here was parked somewhere, and when he hit the back, he got pushed forward. So we could come real close in our launch, probably within 10 feet, I would guess. So that's what we used. We used a distance of 57.6 feet to the landing area. And I didn't know the exact height that he got launched at. So what I did, can you see like a helmet here? I sat on a snowmobile and kind of figured out where the center of gravity was in relation to the ground. And it was like 3 feet, something like that. But I needed his center of gravity that was above the ground and how far he get thrown. Make sense? Just computer work and some monkeying around with chart, this thing basically. And I bracketed the takeoff angle. Now he cleared the windshield. There wasn't any damage to the windshield or the handlebars. So I knew that my bottom angle was like a 21.2. And I didn't figure that he got launched any higher than a 30.4. And that's how far he flew. So the formula that I used, and again, this is a major, major watered down version right here. This is a formula I use. It's all based on projectile motion, but it's watered down for police officers. So all we had to do was measure. This 2.73 is like 30 over there. It's a constant that's figured into the conversion. Okay? Because we're going to get speed in miles per hour in our distances in feet, right? We're not going to try to measure a distance of 50 feet in miles. Does that make sense? We're not going to do that conversion. It's done for us in this. So here's that constant times the distance. Here's my bottom angle, cosine of 21.2, square root. This 3.1 was the height of the center of gravity at takeoff. Basically the center of his chest, which is about the center of gravity on a human, right? And he got thrown a distance of 57.6 feet. Again, I use that angle again. I don't know the derivation of this formula. I'm sure it's not hard to figure out. It's just based on physics and algebra. And what I got for speed was 33 miles per hour when he hit the back of the sled. Does that make sense? That's how fast he was going when he... Now, was that his top speed coming up the trail? No. He slowed down at some point, but he didn't see, he couldn't see through that dust fast enough to scrub off all the speed he had going on that snowmobile. Does that make sense? So that's it. You good? Questions? I got another, I got some pictures in this case. By the time we get up there, he had already been taken away. So here's the snowmobiles when they came together. And they definitely moved after impact. There wasn't a lot of damage. There was more damage than what it looks like. And here is the sled trail. See up here? But where that crosshair is? That's where the snowmobiles were parked. And this was a picture of the trail coming up. See how wide it is? And people just get humming coming up through there. It's all fun up until you hit something, I guess. Here is my diagram. I actually carried that equipment up on the back of the sled while another warden drove about 10 miles down the trail. It was great fun.
So what happened here exactly?
Well, a group of, I think, four or five snowmobiles were coming up the trail. The group pulled over to take a rest. It was kind of flat spot. The last guy didn't see the group stop, and by the time he saw them, it was too late and hit the back of one of them. They really weren't pulled over off the trail very far, and the guy just never saw them stop, hit the back.
So it's kind of hard to brake really quickly. There's no friction.
That's right, the stopping distance on a snowmobile isn't that good. It's going to stop at 40 miles per hour a lot faster than your car.
They weren't running on drugs, right? So that means it was just a freak accident.
We don't call anything freak accidents. Accidents happen for a reason.
We call them crashes. Yeah, it's more of an accident.
So you're called to a scene.
Yeah.
If there are criminal intent charges.
Yeah, sometimes. Or serious crashes.
Or serious crash or death.
Yep.
Has anybody actually died there?
Yep.
Oh, which one?
The guy who hit the back. He got flipped over to the top. Thrown quite a ways. And he landed wrong.
Have you been called to a scene where you have to use animals in your reconstruction, where an animal has been involved?
Not yet. No,
really?
No.
No moose
not
versus...
Yet. No. Moose, and that's actually... We have... when we get into crashes, state employees, we get into a crash with our state vehicle. That's like the only thing they'll forgive is if something runs out in front of you. That is seriously the only thing that they don't find some sort of operator error.
Huh.
So it's kind of interesting. You can hit a moose totally in your truck and get away with it. Yeah. So, it's like the only thing that keeps you out of driving school. Go ahead.
You said if he landed, you said if he died or something because he landed a weird way. If he landed differently, do you think he would have survived it? Because you said he broke his neck.
It sounded like he landed like on his back and neck. The witnesses that we had at the scene, because they were sitting on their sled,
right,
saw him flying. Like, he went like a forward roll after he hit. So he, you know, you're going 33 miles per hour and you hit something, you're going to keep going 33 miles per hour until you wham. And if it had landed in a different way, he might have lived, but the way he landed was, you know, not good. Plus he had hit a certain height, probably. But yeah, I'm guessing it was probably 15 feet up, I would say, something like that.
How many years of schooling do you have to have for your position?
To game warden?
Yeah.
I have a bachelor's degree from 19 something in police administration. I was a police officer in Concord, New Hampshire for like 4 years, and then I got hired over here. So generally a bachelor's degree. And then while I've been here, I've taken a ton of math and physics. I'm actually still working toward a mechanical engineering degree. Just because it's fun. I like learning.
If anyone has any questions, you can ask questions about about any of the training that that he's had to go through, anything he does with his job, what's related to the aspects of physics or related to just being a game warden. Any of those questions. Eric is the star of the TV show Northwood's Law on cable. The show with the main game warden. So
did you guys watch it last night?
I did.
At 10?
No. Oh no, 9:30. You weren't at 10?
Yeah, 10 was tomorrow. I can't stay awake.
I can't.
I watched it last night. It's funny.
Alright, I'll have to catch up on that.
Yeah, it's not bad. You see it next week at 9.
Okay.
It's my plug for Northwood's Law.
So with technology, this is all on paper, somewhat, and
yes,
on the screen. Is there a software program out there now that you can implement this and it makes your own little
skit
of what?
There is. There's motion 3D software. They haven't accepted it in the main courts yet, but there's some excellent, excellent software out there that gives you motion. And I can't wait to learn how to use it. But again, it's not accepted in the main courts right now. So no reconstructionist to me is necessarily using that. But there are some, to do the number crunching, some call we use AI Pro. And all this, they've watered it down so much that it's just algebra. You know, order of operations and algebra. It's not hard math at all. So, you guys good? You want to get out of here? You want to go home? I think I can.